India of the 21st century is different from India of the past centuries. Its aspirations are different, its strengths are different, its leadership is also different. It proactively wants to engage with outside world. It proactively wants to play a role in global politics. India Foundation sees an important role for itself in promoting the Indian ideas on the global stage.
India Foundation has emerged at the forefront of a renaissance in India, which involves the setting up of many domestic and global think tanks. This mirrors India's emergence on the international sphere. After many decades of being inward-looking, India is once again rediscovering its rightful role in helping to shape geopolitics.
A foundation which in a way has laid a strong foundation for informed debate in the country. It has laid foundation for people to come together, think together, apply themselves together, deal with challenging issues, not just by India, but by global community.
The ability to bring up new important concepts, bringing stakeholders together, and then establishing an entire ecosystem wherein which people can express ideas, communicate ideas. All these have been signal and landmark contributions.
It enables the policymaker to meet the other policymakers in an informal setting, not with the formal agendas. It enables policymakers to meet non-policymakers. Therefore, the ideas can come through much better.
These kind of initiatives, the Indian intellectuals coming together on platform, or the peace narrative through Dharma Dharma, or the security narrative through counterterrorism, or the global narrative of Indian Ocean, you can see very structured and systematic way making its impact.
With a new focus on neighborhood, with a new focus on the Indian Ocean, the entire Indian Ocean strategy of the Narendra Modi government has received special attention in the various conferences of India Foundation.
It is already addressing issues around the country. The fact that it is collaborating with state governments, and that is actually helping in spreading what I call the strategic culture all over India.
There has been large number of youth-related activities, whether they're in terms of research scholars, in terms of young thinkers, where we want to create a pipeline and an ecosystem of young people who are engaged on studying, analyzing, researching, and advocating areas of national importance.
It was very, very necessary to have a think tank which spoke differently, which opened up platform for different thought processes and truly Indian-based thought processes.
I see India Foundation more than a think tank. They are more action-oriented in terms of contributing to the key policy areas. And that, I think, has left a major footprint for many other research institutions to follow.
India Foundation is very action-oriented in terms of delivery, in terms of engagements, in terms of productivity.
I can meet a lot of experts from all around the world who inspire me, the icons that I look up to, and I've been able to meet with them and have discussions with them.
We have people who are lawyers, engineers, academicians, social scientists, political scientists, international relations experts. So when we all get together, a lot of different perspectives come into picture, and that is the greatest learning.
It's never really a tough day at India Foundation. Yes, you do face challenges, but we've been trained well and equipped well to deal with them day in and day out.
Visibility, credibility, and relevance. And I think on all these three parameters, India Foundation has come a long way.
Foundation has a very multicultural team. We have people from across India, from various backgrounds that are here. So just sitting in an office that is so multicultural is a learning experience in itself.
We have a lot of youngsters. It's their thoughts and their ideas and their participation that has made it such a vibrant foundation.
You get to collaborate with fellow researchers on a wide range of subjects, which is sometimes not aligned to your area of research, but that is only a good thing because you get to learn more about a lot of things that you would otherwise not be focused on too much.
India Foundation is a very horizontal and a very meritocratic organization. Anyone who has a good idea can share that with the leadership. And if they find merit in this idea, they encourage young scholars and researchers to take a lead and execute these ideas.
We groom our own people. We groom our own talent. That we just don't go about acquiring talent, but we also get a chance to build our own people in and give them the space to grow.
It has helped me grow individually as well as professionally. The amount of awareness, the amount of exposure that India Foundation provides nationally as well as globally is unique.
The objective is clear, to create specialists, not generalists. There are people who are leading these initiatives for 5 years. So they become specialists.
It's the peer learning. Nobody works here in silos. Though there are 4 centers in India Foundation, yet all 4 centers help each other in carrying out its work.
Each one of them brings the core competency besides their specialization in their respective field. I think what they really bring is core integrity. It is that desire to do something for the country. I think that imbued spirit that we want to be change makers.
The working style of the foundation is far beyond the ideal setup. Here, we work not only to achieve the best, but also to improve and learn on day-to-day basis.
India Foundation is a Pathshala which does not believe in creating just good research fellows. It believes in creating good leaders who can contribute to the society's well-being.
We want youngsters to come with fresh ideas, fresh knowledge, no baggage, no hangovers. Come afresh, understand India's potential, understand the preferences, priorities of the government of the day, and based on that, focus their research. So it's a new culture. I'm sure today these scholars look young, but it's a great opportunity for them to grow into eminent, established thinkers in their respective areas in a decade's time. The whole idea is to train youngsters into becoming in-depth scholars and thinkers.
We were not just going to be a simple think tank. We wanted to be more than a think tank, something that was more interventionist, something that could actually bring about the change.
The work of India Foundation actually started long before India Foundation was born. They used to have Thinkers Meet, where it was a very small closed-door gathering where we spoke of a lot of polity matters, media matters, etc. And over the years, that's how this developed.
In 2008, we may not have had the infrastructure. We had a clear idea of who we wanted to be, things that we believed in, issues that we wanted to pick up, policy initiatives that we wanted to research. These were things that were very important to us.
In 2009, when India Foundation really began, it was a brainchild of a few intellectuals of the country who were not happy with how conversations were particularly when everything was looked at from one lens. I think the seed of that idea now has grown into a big tree, where we see the impact of those conversations really informing our policy measures.
Historically, India has never been home to many think tanks. In fact, that has been one of the challenges for us. India Foundation fills the void which was there of not having enough institutional support outside the government to make sure that government and society work together.
Through long-term interactions and focused engagements, India Foundation has built a decade of trust amongst policymakers and stakeholders.
The way it all started was that, you know, we set out on this journey and we were very candid and open and transparent about it. And along this side, we met with many co-travelers, shared the same feeling, the same passion, the same sentiment. They've invariably ended up becoming part of us. We have debated with them, we have argued with them, we have disagreed with them, but that has not stopped us from getting their expertise, getting their insight into this process.
In the course of these 10 years, India Foundation has developed cordial relations with many universities and think tanks in India and abroad.
India Foundation has tried to redefine itself, reinvent itself time and again, trying to evolve a new paradigm.
Without an active participation of the northeast part of our country, it's very difficult to enact India's Act East policy. And this is where India Foundation, with its unique footprint across the country, has been able to create a value impact, wherein it has engaged with various stakeholders within the northeast part of the country, as well as the neighboring countries, culturally as well as civilizationally.
In these 10 years, it has emerged as one of the leading strategic think tanks of India. In India, the whole idea about strategic studies and the concept of security somehow always focused and dwelt only upon the borders. India Foundation was one of those which came forward and managed to change this perception.
What India Foundation has achieved is that it has come this far without compromising on the fundamentals on the basis of which it was set up. So it has not cut corners. It has not tried to be revisionist in its charter.
Ten years is a good landmark. Many things achieved, but many more to be achieved. A journey has begun, but not yet completed. We'll continue on this path of thinking, working, and bringing people together.
May I have your attention, please? We have just been informed that Honorable Shri Pranab Mukherjee will be delayed by about 10 minutes. Thank you.
We believe in encouraging individual initiatives in order to take forward the broader idea of promoting Indian civilizational vision, applying it to contemporary Indian reality, and promoting India's interests.
As India Foundation grew, it was felt that we needed to diversify. Our main focus has been on the field of international affairs and security studies, and Center for Security and Strategy has been the hallmark of India Foundation. Every counterterrorism conference, from the first one, has brought about 40 to 60 countries, and we have had around over 200 experts who have been coming and deliberating.
Laying out the various tenets of terrorism, the issues concerned, and looking at new age terrorism. That is something which really emerged from there. There were not too many think tanks in India which were looking at new age terrorism in any way. And we found that it did not have just a national footprint. It also received a tremendous amount of international contribution.
Some of the events which have been conducted by India Foundation, like the Indian Ocean Conference, this is a conference which is held generally in a country outside India, in one of the ocean rim countries, but which brings together all the key stakeholders. I think that's a very important aspect, because we finally have 40 to 50 countries getting together on a common platform to discuss issues which are of concern. This has made a huge difference in the way all the littoral countries of the Indian Ocean and the other countries who are associated with the ocean look at a particular problem.
India Foundation took this initiative of inviting young leaders from all across the 10 countries of ASEAN, and also we had equal representation from India, which was quite successful and appreciated, and it was a small step which India Foundation towards further establishing linkages between India and ASEAN.
Religion is such an intrinsic part of life in Indian society, so we need to look at the impact of religion on society. The Center for Society and Religion will also be doing the 5th Dharma Dharma Conference.
International Dharma Dhamma Conference, which is a linkage of Buddhism and Hinduism together. And through this platform, we try to bring together religious experts from around the world.
India Ideas Conclave is truly following our traditional ways of vada, of debate, where every point of view would be celebrated. And we would openly, fearlessly, but politely discuss and debate.
India Ideas Conclave essentially gives a platform to multiple ideologies and multiple ideas of India. India Ideas Conclave gets over 300 intellectuals, academics, journalists, activists from across the globe to come and discuss various ideas which define India.
India has great potential for soft power, but somehow we have not strategized this. So we felt that this is something that we must start.
What we are aiming through India's first center dedicated to the research of soft power diplomacy is this: engage with those enabling India's soft power abroad, document some of their activities, also research on some of the areas of their focus, or enable their research going forward.
December 2018, we did the first soft power conference. We had more than 60 plus speakers who had come from more than 15 countries. Again, the same concept, the same verticals of cuisine, Ayurveda, yoga.
The Center for Constitutional and Legal Studies is a very important vertical of India Foundation. Now, one of the major problems which this nation has really been facing is understanding of constitutional and legal issues. We have also carried out a very major seminar with the National Law University at Bhopal on constitutional and legal issues.
As the global power axis shifts from the Pacific Atlantic to the Indo-Pacific, India is today emerging as an important global leader. At this critical juncture, young scholars, academics, professionals from all over the world are very interested in understanding important features of India's public policy and foreign policy. And Kautilya Fellows Program is a forum where in one place, over a short span of time, they can understand what is happening in the world's largest democracy.
The Young Thinkers Meet is a conference where India Foundation invites young minds from across the nation to come together to discuss and deliberate on issues of national interest. We get young policymakers, entrepreneurs, grassroots activists, writers, and artists from all parts of the country.
We have been hosting civic receptions for visiting heads of states, visiting heads of government and important leaders. And to that extent, we have done it for Sri Lankan president, Vietnamese president. Then we also did it for Sheikh Hasina, the Prime Minister of Bangladesh. We have done number of such events.
India Economic Convention was really a place to start debating some of the economic ideas and to get people who are practitioners, people who are economic thinkers, to come and debate that what kind of an economic structure we want, what kind of economic policies we would like to see, what kind of a direction we should take as a government.
The bilateral interactions which we take up shows the diversity which India Foundation engages with. India-Myanmar, we have a bilateral, we have a very strong bilateral with India-Bangladesh, then we have with India-Afghanistan, India-Iran, India-Taiwan, India-China.
Breakfast Briefings is an initiative by India Foundation to create a platform where senior thought leaders from the government and civil society can brief heads of missions of various foreign embassies and international organizations in Delhi about contemporary issues facing the country.
Topics, whether it's economic policy, whether it is India's thinking on trade, India's thinking on national security, all of those have been put in front of a very senior group of diplomats in a very candid, freewheeling format that has been very, very popular and much appreciated.
India Foundation, through its variety of programs, brings together experts from various fields. Strategic experts come together, cultural representatives come together, youth leaders come together, academics, leaders, social thinkers, public intellectuals. Variety of activities bring together variety of scholars. When they come here, when they participate in India Foundation's activity, it's not just like any other academic conference. It's something different for all of them. They see things from a different prism, different perspective, and that prism and perspective is India's rich civilizational experience.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Honorable Pranav Mukherjee will be here in 2 minutes. Kindly bear with us. Sri Pranav Mukherjee has arrived. Our apologies for the delay.
On behalf of India Foundation, I am privileged to welcome our chief guest, Honorable Sri Pranab Mukherjee, the former President of India, and the guest of honor, Sri Suresh Prabhuji, a Member of Parliament. We also welcome the distinguished audience, members of the diplomatic corps, and the media to the second Atal Bihari Vajpayee lecture to be delivered by our former President of India. As we all know, our guest of honors, Sri Suresh Prabhuji, is a Member of Parliament and he is also the PM's Sherpa at G20. He has had a very distinguished public career as a Minister of Railways, Commerce and Industry, and Civil Aviation. Our chief guest requires no introduction. Bharat Ratan Sri Pranab Mukherjee served as the 13th President of India between 2012 and 2017. A politician par excellence with political career spanning over 5 decades. He occupied several ministerial portfolios in the government, including the Office of Minister of Finance, External Affairs, and Defense. He also has the rare distinction of being the leader of both houses of parliament at 2 different times, that is Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. He is a prolific writer, eminent intellectual, and often he is described as the man of all seasons of the Indian politics. He rose to the highest office of the president in 2012. Noting his unparalleled contribution, the government of India conferred upon him the highest civilian award, the Bharat Ratna. I would like to thank both our chief guest and the guest of honor, sir, for accepting to grace the occasion. I also acknowledge with our thanks to the family of Sri Vajpayee, Namita, and Sri Ranjan Bhattacharya for being here. May I now invite Sri Suresh Prabhuji to deliver the welcome address.
Good evening, friends. Today is a very special day for us. Atal Bihari Vajpayee, the leader who continues to live in the hearts of millions of people even today, we are going to remember him and going to reminisce many of unforgettable moments of his life, and in a manner that's most befitting is to talk about the parliamentary democracy. Atalji would have been 95 on 25th of December. He spent almost good part of his working life in the parliament on both the sides. He was in both the houses, and he was a parliamentarian par excellence. Now it's very difficult to say whether he was a better parliamentarian, better poet, or a better human being, or obviously a better statesman. But he lived all that in one life, and we are going to remember him very fondly once again when we have the members of his family and members of his extended family. It's very difficult to say who is not a member of Atalji's family. And therefore, it's a family event in which a great son of India is going to deliver a second Atal Bihari Vajpayee memorial lecture. The first one was delivered, I would call, a disciple of Atalji, Arun Jaitley. And now we'll be delivering by a good friend of Atalji, contemporary, who lived with him and debated with him on many occasions, and we are going to hear him. Atalji was a great reformer. Electricity Act, disinvestment, Fiscal Responsibility Budget Management Act, first time in India to put restriction on government's own spending to ensure that we have fiscal prudence as a guiding principle for state policy. So he was a great reformer. He was a great connector, not only connected with hearts of many people through his great oratory, but also telecom, rural roads, golden quadrilateral, river linking, were all his programs to link the different parts of the country and also link people with the mainstream. He was also a bold leader. He brought Pokhran II, which made world really shiver, but he also had a great healer. He actually took steps to rebuild a relationship with the rest of the world. We are very fortunate to have a great, as I said, the India Foundation job is to lay foundation for India. And in that, there are many events that take place, and you just saw the film, in which young leaders are also invited to take part into the Young Thinkers Meet. But also we are very fortunate that foundation of India can be laid only by the great sons of India. And we are going to talk about Atalji, a great son of the country, by another great son of the country, Pranab Mukherjee, who again has spent good part of his life, right from 1969, into the parliament. And interestingly, when Atalji used to be in opposition, Pranada will be in the ruling party. And they changed sides, but they did not change the relationship with each other. They shared a very close personal bond. They were neighbors for a long time, and as politicians do, they never had a dog fight, but you'll remember, your dogs had fight with each other. And therefore, this is a very unique relationship, and we are going to hear about a future of parliamentary democracy from someone who has been a most eminent parliamentarian, repository and a depository of knowledge. You can go to him and ask him about something which happened in 1945. He will give the complete reference of it, but also he'll tell you, please read this book on page 47, on line 17, you will read this particular line. This is his memory. And anytime you can go to him on any issue, you'll always be guided properly with proper perspective. And that time he'll not think on party lines, but think about a country, a statesman like Atalji. And therefore, we are going to hear him. And as you said, my friend just now said that he is a man of all season, but also seasoned statesman. man of all season, but definitely a seasoned statesman. And he has handled all important portfolios, and I would say he's an amalgam of wisdom and intellect. And therefore, it will be very nice to hear him and get some insights into parliamentary democracy. There are many similarities. Both were awarded Bharat Ratnas. Both held very highest offices, one as Member of Parliament, one as a President. And both were December born. I wish I was born in the same month. And both great parliamentarians, and therefore we are going to hear him. For me, it's a moment of delight. Atalji, I held 6 cabinet positions under him. He was my boss. Of course, a leader of all times for me, but boss during that period. But more importantly, I was a recipient of his unadulterated love and an always a fatherly treatment from him. So for me, it's a great moment of rejoice to think about him again. And Pranabda, when I came to the parliament and I became minister the first day I became to the parliament, when I used to answer questions in the parliament, the great leader like him would write a small note to me and say, encourage me that you answered it so well. Just imagine someone as senior as him talking to as small a person like me and encouraging me to do that. I will never forget that moment. And I kept those small notes as something which like a memoir for me. So we are very happy that we are going to do this. And as I said, India Foundation is very fortunate that we are getting this honor of organizing this lecture in honor of Atalji, because for Atalji he was a father figure for all of us, and we feel that parliamentary democracy can function only when we have these two opposite opinions on each other who try to work in harmony for development of the country. And that's what we are going to hear him. I'm extremely happy that we got this honor. On behalf of all of you, let me thank our former President of India for giving this honor and sparing time to do this. So thank you very much, Mr. President.
May I now request Sri Suresh Prabhuji to felicitate our chief guest, Honorable Sri Pranab Mukherjee. After the felicitation, we will have a short film clip on the life of Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee, and which will be immediately followed by the talk delivered by the former President, Honorable Sri Pranab Mukherjee.
बरसे यदि ज्वालाएं निज हाथों से हंसते हंसते आग लगाकर चलना होगा कदम मिलाकर चलना होगा यहां से रुदन में तूफानों में अमर असंख्यक बलिदानों में उद्यानों में वीरानों में अपमानों में सम्मानों में उन्नत मस्तक उभरा सीना पीड़ाओं में पलना होगा कदम मिलाकर चलना होगा समय के प्रधानमंत्री नरसिंह राव जी ने भारत का पक्ष रखने के लिए मुझे विरोधी दल के नेता के नाते जेनेवा भेजा था और पाकिस्तानी उसे देखकर चमत्कृत रह गए उन्होंने कहा कि ये कहां से आए क्योंकि उनके यहां विरोधी दल का नेता
ऐसे राष्ट्रीय कार्य में भी सहयोग देने के लिए तैयार नहीं होता, वो हर जगह अपने सरकार को गिराने के काम में लगा रहता है। ये हमारी परंपरा नहीं है, ये हमारी प्रकृति नहीं है, और मैं चाहता हूं ये परंपरा बनी रहे, ये प्रकृति बनी रहे। सत्ता का खेल तो चलेगा, सरकारें आएंगी जाएंगी, पार्टियां बनेंगी बिगड़ेंगी, मगर ये देश रहना चाहिए, इस देश का लोकतंत्र अमर रहना चाहिए।
टूटे हुए सपने की सुने कौन सिसकी, टूटे हुए सपने की सुने कौन सिसकी, अंतर को चीर व्यथा पलकों पर ठिठकी, हार नहीं मानूंगा रार नहीं ठानूंगा, काल के कपाल पर लिखता मिटाता हूं, गीत नया गाता हूं, गीत नया गाता हूं।
Good evening, Sri Suresh Prabhu, Member Parliament, Vice Admiral Shekhar Sinha, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's indeed a privilege for me to be amidst you this evening to deliver the second Atal Bihari Vajpayee Memorial Lecture. Atalji was a great son of India. Although we worked in ideologically opposite pillars of the polity, his innate qualities as an orator, as a moderator, as a consensus keeper, in both his role as opposition leader and later as Prime Minister, greatly impressed the Indian political scenario. As a statesman and a political stalwart, he dominated the national space for a very long period of time. As a prime minister, he kept the nation first. As an opposition leader, he was sharp, but matured in his critic. As a democrat, he was one of the few leaders who thought of every angle before taking a decision. As an orator, he could enthrall the masses with his chest linguistic skill. As a policymaker, he did not shy away from taking some tough decisions. I have no hesitation in saying that he was an inheritor and practitioner of the best traditions and qualities of leadership that India can be proud of. Atal Bihari Vajpayee was very visible presence in Indian politics for almost six decades, entering Parliament in 1957 and continuing till 2009. He was part of the Bharatiya Jan Sangh since it was founded by Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee in 1951 and watched it grow in strength. Since the fourth Lok Sabha in 1967, Vajpayee ji virtually acted as the leader of the opposition, despite the fact that no party was recognized as an opposition party from 1952 to 1977, as they did not have the minimum number of members required to be designated as a party. And the leader of the biggest party in opposition is entitled to be the LOP, leader of opposition. India and Indians intrinsically cannot digest bigotry and division over a sustained period. We are a nation of 1.3 billion people residing 12,69,219 square miles, participating, practicing 7 major religions, speaking 122 languages, 1,600 dialects in our everyday life, belonging to 3 major ethnic groups, Caucasians, Dravidians, Mongoloids, yet represented by one constitution with one identity, that is Indian or Bharatiya. Atalji accepted this reality. He shaped his vision for everyone, seeking to take everyone along, even though many may not have agreed with his ideological inclinations. A strident, yet reasoned voice in the opposition, Vajpayee ji remained a consent seeker while successfully leading the first coalition government for full 5-year term, though the term was 6 years in 2 spells. Despite the limitations of a coalition, he deftly managed to navigate issues in Kashmir, talks with Pakistan, and the second nuclear explosion at Pokhran. As Prime Minister, Vajpayee carried on the economic reforms process begun by P.V. Narasimha Rao and Dr. Manmohan Singh in 1991, and ensured steady growth of Indian economy at an average rate of 6%. I remember an instance that shows the spirit of cooperation with the opposition. As Commerce Minister in P.V. Narasimha Rao's government, I signed the WTO agreement in 1995 at Marrakesh Declaration. This was fiercely opposed by the opposition parties in the country. Both BJP and left parties combined to oppose this, India's participation in WTO. As per the provisions of the WTO agreement, particularly under IPR, intellectual property rights, India was to amend the Indian Patent Act 1973 to provide the product patents to the products. We did not have that arrangement. So we are given 5 years' time to amend the Indian Patent Act 1973, and in between, if a new product comes to the market, India will have to give the exclusive marketing right to that product. But unfortunately, though Lok Sabha passed it, Raj Sabha could not pass it twice. This happened in 95 and early 96. In between, there was a regime change. The government which followed after Congress was led by H.D. Devegowda, followed by I.K. Gujral. And thereafter, Sri Vajpayee took over as leader of the National Democratic Alliance. And during that period, the situation reached a flashpoint. When India did not comply with the conditions of IPR, some member moved a resolution in the dispute settlement mechanism of World Trade Organization and demanded the expulsion of India from WTO. Government of India fought seriously. Finally, at Geneva, Sholi Shorabji was sent as counsel of India. He came back and said, sorry, the amendment is to be carried out. There is no other alternative, or to face the consequences of being expelled from the WTO. Vajpayee ji talked to Dr. Manmohan Singh, who was the leader of the opposition in that Sabha. Dr. Singh talked to me, then both of us met him. He jokingly told me, Pranab Babu, it is your baby. Why are you not carrying it? I'm ready to carry it, sir, but let me first carry my party. Because they are trying to have a vengeance and fulfill their anguishness to teach the ruling party a lesson, as they had to suffer a humiliation in 1995. When we talked to Mrs. Sonia Gandhi, Congress President, she suggested to me that you carry conviction with the members of the Congress Parliamentary Party. We did so, and finally it was decided that we will support the WTO proposal, and then while trying to convince the Congress members in both the houses, I told them that you have not noticed in your anxiety that there are only two differences between the bill which was introduced by me in 1995 and the bill which is under consideration right now in 2003. The only difference is title of the bill. The bill I introduced had the title, had the date of 1995, and the bill which is now under consideration has the date of 2001. And there is another change, and that is at the end of the bill in the docket you will find it is mentioned the name of the member in charge, not minister, member in charge, because the British practice is still going on that the member introduces the bill. So the name of the minister was, in my bill it was Pranab Mukherjee, and the bill under consideration in 2001, the name of the commerce minister was Mr. Mursuli Maran. And then I told my Congress colleagues that find out the difference except these two. So all of them laughed, and it was agreed that we will support the bill. The short point which I am trying to drive at, that he did not fail to recognize the need of cooperation with the opposition as and when. It was really, as I know, being the commerce minister twice in the government of India, and also the main negotiator from political side, official side, Mr. Ganeshan was the negotiator. The importance and significance of it. Some other big countries is still trying today to be the founding member of the WTO. But India, as it was founding member of GATT, we were eager to retain that status, and we retained it. It would have been lost but for the effective intervention of Vajpayee. Another occasion also I can say that how he looked at opposition's cooperation and what was his attitude towards the opposition. All of you are aware, in December 2013, there was attack on, exact year I am forgetting, not 2013. I think it was 13th December. Exact year I have forgotten, but Vajpayee was Prime Minister when the terrorists attacked the Parliament House, 2001. And while talking on the situation next day, Vajpayee mentioned, if he did not mention, we did not know, that Indian democracy is safe. When this incident took place, Mrs. Sonia Gandhi was not present in the house, but she telephoned my office and inquired about the well-being of the Prime Minister. If the leader of the opposition in a crisis like this takes note of the well-being of the Prime Minister, I can safely say Indian economy, Indian democracy is in safe hands. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, having spoken about Atalji and our general policy, I would now like to take the opportunity to share my thoughts on the topic, has parliamentary democracy succeeded in India and the challenges ahead? Last month, this year, we observed two important milestones in our constitutional history. We celebrated the 70th Foundation Day of adoption of Indian Constitution on 26th November 1949, 26th November. The members of the Constituent Assembly on behalf of India adopted, enacted, and gave to themselves, people of India, the constitution which was drafted and enacted but operationalized because of certain other reasons on 26 January 1950. The second important event was 250th session of Raj Sabha. Raj Sabha, being the permanent house, has a continuous session, has a continuity, and sessions are counted for Lok Sabha. It is first, second, third, fourth. Currently it is 17th Lok Sabha. But in Raj Sabha from day one in the May 1952 till the current session, it is the 250th session. Indian parliamentary system has succeeded, deepened, and is flourishing. It has over the past 7 decades, as one election after another election, not only successfully enforced the spirit of socio-economic transformation that our constitution provided, but also reflected on the aspirations, desire, and resolve of the people every time they voted. In my mind, every election since 1952, barring those of 1996 and 2004, was a decisive mandate by the Indian electorate for or against a political party or group of political parties. This not displays the innate maturity of our people, but is a characteristic of maturing democracy. In all the Lok Sabha elections from 1952 to 1984, the Indian electorate provided an adequate mandate to the Indian National Congress, except in 1977, when the Janata Party, whose constituents fought under one common symbol, one common name, attained a decisive majority in their favor. But unfortunately, the government did not last. Many political observers hold a view that 1989 election were the actual turning point where the Indian electorate did not provide a decisive mandate. However, the mandate was certainly against the ruling party. In 1989, Congress got the largest number of seats, 195. Then it was followed by Sri V.P. Singh's Janata Dal with 142 seats and BJP with 88 seats. In a realignment of forces, the BJP and the left parties came together to support V.P. Singh government from outside. Realism and real politics overtook the ideological leanings. The reality was also not to force one more general election within a short span of time in a country of India's size. To a large extent, this signaled a maturity of our Indian democracy. And from another angle, if you look at it, from 1989 to 2014, there were several Lok Sabha elections, 89 to 99. In a span of 10 years, there should have been in normal course 3 elections, 89, 94-99. But actually five elections took place. 89, 91, 96, 98, 99. People started thinking of having a new model. Somebody talked of German model. Somebody talked of positive motion, side by side, no confidence motion. But nothing required. I remember in one of the parliamentary party meeting of my party, I told them, Indian electorate and elected members are matured enough to find a solution. We shall have not to go anywhere to find a model for it. We will find a model for ourselves. And the model was simple. Major political parties decided not to bring any frivolous, no confidence motion which will cause disturbance to the government. And remember, from 89 to 91, several governments collapsed. But from 99 to 2014, the coalition governments continued. Because people, political parties, they restrained themselves. They did not indulge in changing the government. Therefore, Indian electoral system and parliamentary democracy in that way has been a successful one. Coming back to the nature of the mandate, to my mind, in 2004 results were also not decisive. Purely in terms of the deepening democracy, these results were a watershed event, which belied the predictions of many political pundits. Even though the pre-poll coalition of Congress was significantly ahead in number of their seats compared to that of BJP and its allies, they were still short of the majority. UPA 218, NDA 181, but UPA 1 continued. Even in 1991 to 96, P.V. Narasimha Rao did never get 275. Actually, he won the number 226, and after Punjab election and several other elections, he increased the strength, but never reached 275, but carried on the full five-year term. Another significant achievement of the Indian parliamentary system, based on the first past the post system, is indeed, our electorate has its ability to achieve the balance between the electoral majorities and majoritarianism. If you notice the election results from 52 to 2019, in no election Indian electorate gave any political parties 51% of the total votes polled. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru in 57 got somewhere between 48.7% with a massive number of seats, 372 out of 400 plus. And in 1984, Mr. Rajiv Gandhi got 415 out of 495, but not 51% of the votes, 48% plus. What does it mean? To my mind, Indian electorate convey a message through these voting patterns. To the ruling party, the message is, I give you enough number of seats. Form the government, carry on. Transact your business. Fulfill your commitment by passing legislations. Number is not the issue, but carry others. Always remember, a large chunk of the voter who participated in the vote did not give you vote, did not support you, carry on. That is the message Indian electorate are giving through these elections. The Indian electorate has time and again conveyed to the ruling party that goes on to form the government. Yes, they may be entitled to form the government with majority, of the seats won by them, but they are also to take the consideration into the views of all those people who may not have voted for them. The mandate is governed as a majority party with a stable government, but carry others with you. It is also to be noted that every time a government has behaved on the contrary, the voter has punished the incumbent in the elections that follow. Unfortunately, the message of the Indian electorate has never been clearly understood by the political players. That is why we think we can do anything and everything when we have an overwhelming majority in the legislature, but that should not be the case. In this connection, I would like to point out, I'm quoting it from my own speech which I delivered as president on the Republican Day Eve in 2014. I said, 2014 is a precipice moment in our history. We must remember elections do not give any person or any party the license to flirt with illusions. Those who seek the trust of the votes must promise only what is possible. Government is not a charity shop. Populist anarchy cannot be substituted for governance. False promises lead to disillusionment, which gives birth to rage. And that rage has the legitimate target, those who are in power. We must rediscover that sense of national purpose and patriotism which lifts the nation above and across the abyss and back on the road of prosperity. Give the young jobs and they will realize what we want to have. They will raise the villages and the cities to 21st century standards. Give them a chance and you will be marvel at what India can create. The chance will not come if India does not get a stable government. This year, we will witness the 16th general election to our Lok Sabha. A fractured government, hostage to whimsical opportunists, is always an unhappy eventuality. In 2014, it could be catastrophic. Each one of us is a voter. Each one of us has a deep responsibility. We cannot let India down. It is time for introspection and action. That's why I do say that our politicians have failed to take the lessons of the mandate which people give. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, having spoken about our tested parliamentary system during the last 70 years, let me trace back its roots and the rationale behind adopting it. India's experience with representative democracy and institutions attained organic growth in Indian soil because they were home to the republican forms of government, deliberative, representative bodies, and self-governing institutions from as early as the Vedic age. Our experiences with the representative government started in the republics, Ganrajya, of Lichchavi, Kapilavastu, Paba, Kushinara, Ramanagaram, Shushamagri, Piplai, Suful, Mithila, and Kalinga in the 6th century BC and continued till 400 AD. Shabhat Samitis and Ganpati of these republics were the modern day parliament, cabinet, and the prime ministers, respectively. Representative bodies in the village level, the Gram Panchayat, Gram Sabhas, and Panchayats continued to flourish through the medieval and Mughal periods in the advent of the British Raj. The origins of the modern-day legislation process can be traced back in the 1601 charter which was given to East India Company by Queen Elizabeth I and which runs, I quote, to make, ordain, constitute such and so many laws, constitutions, orders, and ordinances as shall seem necessary and convenient for good governance. The Regulating Act of 1773 holds a special significance in the legislative history of India because it marks the beginning of a parliamentary control over the governance of the company. It is also said to have started the process of territorial integration and administrative centralization in India. The Charter Act of 1833 terminated the trading rights of the East India Company, rendering it merely an administrative agency of the Crown in India. It set up one legislative council for the British territories in India and for the first time differentiated the legislative functions of the government and its executive functions. Under the Charter of 1853, discussions in the council were acting in the legislative capacity became oral instead of in writing. Legislative business was conducted in public and reports and proceedings were officially published regularly. After a series of such reforms, during the East India Company's rule, finally the proclamation of Queen Victoria in 1858, British Crown took the responsibility of administering this vast territory and British Crown ruled this country, administered India through a Secretary of State accountable to the House of Commons on behalf of the British Cabinet. Though not in the hands of the elected representatives of India, but the government of India, governance of India was transferred to a body which was accountable to Parliament of Great Britain. I would like to draw your attention towards the following landmark acts that incrementally, though grudgingly, devolved and transferred the dictum of the parliamentary system in India through doges. The Act of 1909, which is popularly known as Morley Monto reforms, which created a non-official majority of all the provincial legislative councils but maintained official majority in the Central Legislative Council. It is this act which repeatedly introduced for the first time in the principle of communal representation in India. Government of India Act 1990, Montagu Chelmsford reform that introduced the system of diarchy in 8 major provinces known as governor's province. It was the act introduced the concept of division of the subjects for administration between central and provincial governments. Government of India Act 1935, which did away with the diarchy and bicameral legislations were introduced in provinces, ensuring a bicameral federal legislature. While elections in various provincial assemblies took place in 1937 with a limited franchise, and it resulted in the popular government in the province. The federal part of the Act of 1935 did never come into operation because there was no decision about the participation of princely rulers in the system. Even thereafter, the British Parliament, the last act which they passed in passing the Indian Independence Act of 1947, in putting into place transitory rules, to a large extent functioned as Parliament of India. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, post-independence India's experience of parliamentary system can be divided into three phases. The first phase constitutes the decades when the influence of the British government was predominant, with the effort was to assess our function with reference to the British system. With time, we evolved our own practices and laws and conventions by overreaching values enshrined in our constitution. The second phase of India's parliamentary system took place in the 1990s. This was the deeply competitive multi-party coalition stage, necessitating many changes in the practice of parliamentary systems. The presidential style of the leader of dominant party could no longer influence the functioning of parliament. The fact since 1970, but more so during the second phase of the 1990s, not only the state governments, but even the central governments fell because of the no confidence motion, a powerful tool to maintain the checks and balances in a parliamentary democracy. While the allegedly assured its instability, it also ensured greater accountability and representation of disparate socio-economic groups. Despite the inherent contradiction of this coalition phase, the nation made unprecedented progress under government from various governments from 1991 to 2009. The third phase began shaping when the multi-party system slowly started evolving into the bipolar system. Two major coalition leaders came into being as manifested in the elections of 1998. This change became fully perceptible in 2014, with the first clear majority government being elected to power since 1984, after 30 years, and got solidly reaffirmed in 2019 Lok Sabha elections. This marked a new phase of Indian democracy, circling back to dominant party system that the election still 1984 threw off. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is abundantly clear that the parliamentary system of democracy, as emphasized in our constitution, has not only succeeded, but deeply rooted itself. It has also served the country well. However, I would like to draw the attention of this distinguished gathering and all concerned some of the shortcomings that have crept in over time in our parliamentary system, which need to be addressed and corrected sooner than better. Disproportionately large size of the electorate vis-a-vis the number of people's representatives. The last enhancements of the seats in Lok Sabha took place in 1977, almost half a century ago, on the basis of 1971 census, according to which the entire population of the country at that point of time was 55 crores, 550 million, not 1.3 billion today. Therefore, there has been an embargo on the increasing the number of seats in parliament and state assemblies till the year 2026. This has resulted in the fact that the number of voters per Lok Sabha constituency as per 2011 census has risen to more than 16 lakh. In the last general elections of 2019, approximately 90 crore voters were enrolled and were eligible for voting 543 members of the Lok Sabha. Nearly two-thirds of them exercised their voting rights. With an average 16 to 18 lakh people having one representative in parliament, how can we expect the representative to be in touch with the electorate. There is a strong case for removing this freeze on the number of seats in the delimitation exercise. Whenever there is a question of removing this freeze of the number of seats, which should ideally increase to about 1,000 Lok Sabha MPs, with correspondingly a rise in the number of Raj Sabha MPs, more than often the arguments are given the logistic problems. I do consider it is no major problem. Even with the existing infrastructure available, Central Hall could easily be converted into Lok Sabha. Lok Sabha can easily be converted into Raj Sabha, and Raj Sabha can be converted into the lobby, or Central Hall's role can be assigned to it. If we think innovatively, it would be possible to find out a solution. But it is high time for us to think of, if the British Parliament can have 650 members, Canadian Parliament can have 443 members, United States Congress House of Representatives have 535 members, then why can't India have 1,000 members in Lok Sabha and appropriately increased numbers in Raj Sabha? I seriously wonder how the logistic questions arise in these matters. Adequate representation of women is another issue which should be considered seriously now. I congratulate the 17th Lok Sabha for electing 14.6% of its total strength as women representative, which is the highest since 1952. The third issue which comes, and more than often a demand is being raised, that there should be simultaneous election of the Lok Sabha and Assembly. You may hold simultaneous election, Lok Sabha and Assembly, by one time, making constitutional amendments, making agreeable to all the states. But how do you ensure that in between the members would not express their lack of confidence in the Council of Ministers? How would you ensure that? What is the guarantee that? Why frequent election take place when there is not adequate number to carry on the government? There is no constitutional guarantee that you can assure a house will ensure if you do not artificially prevent them from take action. Because what is accountability? Executive has the power. Legislative has the power to control the executive by exercising its right, putting most of no confidence, removing the ministers. To balance that, executive has the power, prime minister has the power. In 1905, through Lord Salisbury's ruling to Queen Victoria, it was decided, and thereafter all parliamentary systems more or less accepted, that if prime minister advises the president, or in case of Britain, prime minister advises the queen or king, king or queen usually accept that. In India also it has been accepted. When Mrs. Indira Gandhi dissolved 4th Lok Sabha in 1971, president accepted her recommendation. In 1979, when the Janata Party government collapsed, you will recollect when Chaudhary Charan Singh formed the government and met president, president suggested to him to carry on the government till the alternative is being made. He tried to find out an alternative, but when he found that it is not possible, on the second day, he accepted his resolution of dissolving the house, and the house was dissolved. Therefore, in India also, the precedents are that president's advice on these matters, prime minister's advice on these matters have been simultaneously accepted by the president without raising the questions. Therefore, this issue is also to be sorted out, and I do feel it is high time. Another point of which I am afraid, almost like a parrot, on more than several occasions, I said, I do never agree with anyone who suggests that disruption is an effective parliamentary intervention. I do feel disruption of the House is nothing but gagging the members and a few members coming to the well, causing disturbances and disruptions, prevent the large number of members and through them the right of the large number of people who have sent them to the House to speak their own voices. Therefore, disruption must be prevented and it can never be used as an effective parliamentary intervention. It is nothing but some sort of stagnation and creation a deadlock in the House. Therefore, to my mind, any disruption should be dealt firmly by the Ethics Committee of the Parliament or by any other appropriate body which the Parliament may consider. And Ethics Committee of Parliament is not as important as people think. When I was the leader of the House in 2004 to 2012, twice, in 2005, December, 11 members of the Lok Sabha were suspended for taking money on putting questions, and the Ethics Committee make their recommendation. Their recommendation as leader of the House, I placed before the House and got it approved. 11 members lost their membership. Therefore, if the Ethics Committee or any other appropriate committee is entrusted with this responsibility, identifying the perpetual disruptors and take action against them, I do feel it would be possible to handle the situation. Two other important issues which are, to my mind, the shortcomings. I have spent 48 years of my life in Parliament and around, 5 years, of course, in Raisina Hills. Though I was not a member of either of the two houses, but by virtue of the Constitution, I was a member, an integral part of the constituent unit of the Parliament. As Constitution says, the Indian Parliament consists of President and two houses, House of People and Council of States. And from my experiences of these 48 years, I can tell you that certain corrective measures are required to be taken. And fortunately, in one such suggestion, Vajpayee agreed. And if he would have continued, perhaps it could have been done. All of you are aware of the PAC, Public Accounts Committee, which is one of the oldest public account committee in the world. Even before independence in 1921, in Indian Central Legislative Assembly, Public Account Committee was created by a motion moved by Motilal Nehru, and it was encouraged by the then British Speaker to have the Public Account Committee. From 1921, Public Account Committee is working. Public Account Committee is the watchdog of the Parliament on the expenditures which the government incurs, because they are bound to incur only that amount of expenditure and for that services for which Parliament has sanctioned. There are 150 plus demands for which Parliament is to exercise its authority and control, except Parliament. Precisely the elected House of Parliament, nobody else can have that right to grant, to sanction, to approve the expenditure. Not a single penny could be spent from the Consolidated Fund of India without the approval of Parliament. And approval of Parliament is sought through the demands for grants. But because of the paucity of time, you will notice in every budget session, this budget session also you have noticed, there is a day fixed for guillotine. What is meant by guillotine? That the demands which are not being discussed on the floor of the House, at the end of the day, Speaker will come and say, on the specific period, giving 3 weeks or so, that you people are lazy, you have not done enough job. 150 plus demands are to be passed. Therefore, I don't want to give any more time to the House to discuss it. I will put all the demands in guillotine. And it is worth saying that in half an hour or 45 minutes, thousands of crores of rupees are approved on behalf of Parliament. it is not proper. Because no tax can be levied or imposed. Not even the rate could be fixed, except the authority of Parliament. No money could be spent, except the authority of Parliament. No services can be created, except the approval of Parliament. These three most important functions of Parliament, people's representative, and which, if somebody traces the history of it, will find from the Magna Carta of 1215. These rights, if this is to be properly exercised, to my mind, a time has come when we shall have to think innovatively. One way could be, and Vajpayee suggested, that from 1991 we have created a large number of standing committees. Those standing committees' strength has a number has also been increased. It can be further increased. And whatever items of expenditure, its irregularity, pointed out by CAG, is taken over by PSE. Let them take it over. But many other items on which critical references have been made by CAG are not taken into consideration. Let these standing committees be entrusted with scrutinizing them, just like PSE, without diluting their authorities and command. But they could have some sort of scrutiny, some sort of examination, so that the executive is accountable to them for their expenditures which they are incurring. The present day functioning of the standing committees are three. One is to scrutinize the grants which the finance minister is allocating for the department to which the standing committee is related. But this power is limited that they cannot change the amount, because amount is supposed to be done, changed, approved by the whole house, not by the part of house. Standing committee is the part of the house. They cannot appropriate the authority of the whole of the house. Therefore, this is one. Second, annual report. And third, if a bill is referred to them, and nowadays the practices are also coming, sometimes the ministers come, and in that case I was no exception, I also used to come sometimes to request the speaker, sir, the bill is very urgent, please allow it to be debated, discussed and passed here, don't send it to standing committee. More than often these demands come. Therefore, what do I suggest? That these standing committees be entrusted, if necessary, number could be increased, and they can work simultaneously. Some logistic facilities are to be created, that Parliament should be in a position to do that. Another point I would like to draw your attention, that we should be very careful about scrutinizing the functioning of the Parliament. It is easy to denigrate an institution, but it takes time to build up the institution. Parliament as an institution is growing, has developed over the years. I can dismiss it, that it is fish market. It does not serve any purpose. Sometimes the criticism may be appropriate, but it should not be indulged in. Institution must be respected. It is only through the institution a system in modern days complex economy and administration, only through the institutions the system can run smoothly. And if we can strengthen these institutions, it would be possible for us to ensure that our parliamentary system gives the best. While paying my respect once more to Atal Bihari Vajpayee, I would like to sum up my observations, and particularly the role of the parliamentarian my advice would be, and perhaps as a fellow parliamentarian or erstwhile fellow parliamentarian, I can claim that as 48 years of my life I spent with you, I can give you an advice. A numerical majority of elections gives you the right to make a stable government. But please carry on with others. Lack of popular majority forbids you from a majoritarian government. That is the message and essence of our parliamentary democracy. Please do follow. Our forefathers have done well. We are also carrying on that legacy, trying our best, but let us take it to the ultimate objective of as much as possible fault-free system, which will be perhaps the most appropriate tribute to the man in whose honor and memory we are delivering this lecture today. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Jai Hind.
Let me thank Mr. Pranab Mukherjee for giving this great lecture. May I request all of you to please give him a real standing ovation for praising and spelling out the. Another very interesting thing, this lecture, I thank and congratulate Mr. Ram Madhav for organizing this lecture in a place which couldn't have been more appropriate for delivering lecture on parliamentary democracy, because it is in Dr. Ambedkar Bhavan and in Bhim Hall, which is the, who is the father of the country.
Please remain standing for the national anthem.
Janagana mana adhinayaka jaya hai Bharat bhagya vidhata Punjab, Sindh, Gujarat, Maratha, Dravida, Utkala, Vanga, Vindhya, Himachala, Yamuna, Ganga, Uchala, Jaladhi, Taranga, Tava Shubha Name Jage, Tava Shubha Ashish Mage, गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे